And if there's a reason I'm still alive and everyone around me has died, I'm willing to wait for it. I'm willing to wait for it, wait for it. I might have to watch it again, despite King George's spitting. It just might have
you
to happen.
Remember this, a kiss is still a kiss.
Hey everybody, welcome to my channel. My name is Maya. Feel free to click the subscribe button if you are new. And if you're returning, welcome back. So great to see you on this fine sunny Sunday. Of course it is Saturday when I'm filming this, but we do not care about time here. Time has no meaning anymore. So I spent the last, you know, hour and a half watching about 8 short films on Disney Plus as well as YouTube. They were primarily Disney and Pixar shorts. You know, the ones that come before movies. Back when we had movie theaters, they would play them after the previews, but before the actual film, like when the lights were just getting dim. Oh, do you remember those days? But I thought that we could talk about these shorts I watched today, their pros, their cons, why certain ones stand out, and really why I honestly prefer short films usually. There are exceptions onward. I generally prefer short films to their accompanying feature film. With that, let's hop into it. Our first short I will be talking about today is La Luna. So La Luna, let's set the scene. There's a grandfather, a father, and a son, and they are on a boat in the middle of an ocean. It is nighttime, all is quiet, all is still. They use a lot of negative space in this film, but it doesn't feel scary or intimidating. It actually promotes a calming, serene atmosphere. And all of a sudden, the dad hands the son this ladder and says, "All right, son, best climb up to the moon right there. You see it?" And the son's like, "Okay, gulp." And he does. He climbs up to the moon. It's important to note here, no one actually tells him to climb up to the moon. It's all implied because short films are typically without words, and if they have words, usually the words are in the form of music. They are lyrics. So the sun climbs up to the moon, okay? He's there. He's standing on the moon, and he's surrounded by these glowing fallen stars. Now, I did think they were starfish for a solid 30 seconds, but no, it turns out they're falling stars, okay? So just an FYI, not starfish. And his dad and grandpa join him and they sweep stars like to different parts of the moon, like they're the janitors for the moon. And then when they go back to their little boat, you see that they kind of created the moon's phase. It's now a crescent moon when originally it was a full moon. La Luna really promotes this idea of a childlike dreamscape. So everything seems a little fantastical, but it's in a way that doesn't feel disconcerting or like an out-of-body experience. Instead, it's filled with a sort of wonder and innocence that really can only come when your main character is a child. Really, at the end of the day, La Luna shows us that magic can be simple. We can find magic in the smallest of things, whether that's something like the cycle of the moon, its phases, crescent. My 7th grade science teacher would be so disappointed. There's a gibbous, waxing and waning. Waxing and waning gibbous, full moon, blue moon. You know, we see the moon every day. It's kind of a consistent, mundane part of life. But when you really think about it, it's pretty incredible that there's like a moon up there, that like we're just tiny little specks in the galaxy. And I think that shorts like this really emphasize that sense of wonder and smallness while reminding us that small is good. It's okay to be little and appreciate the magnitude of the universe around you. Next, I rewatched, because I've seen this one, Bao. Bao follows a mother. I believe they're in Canada because the dad is wearing a Canada sweater, which I thought was adorable. And she has a son, but her son the entire time is in the shape of a bao, which is a sort of dumpling. Her son is a dumpling, and she raises her little dumpling, and they have fun, and they have rituals. They do Tai Chi in the park. They get like yummy dessert buns all the time, but then he grows up and he distances himself from her, and it really breaks her heart. So at the end of the short film, she ends up eating him. And this could seem odd. This is meant to symbolize parenthood, really. And the idea of, although we know deep down that change is good and it can lead to really beautiful things, it's painful to go through in the moment. We want to stop it with everything in our being. So to try to prevent her son from growing up and to try to get him to stay with her, she symbolically ate him, but then she realizes not only is that not the best thing for her, but it's not the best thing for her son. Some other notes I took for Bao before we move on to our next short was, one, tears can mean many things. I think that was a really subtle message within Bao, but one that really got to my heart. Two, this short used a lot of humorous over-exaggeration, specifically when it comes to facial features. The last note I have is that it's okay to let something go and still love it. But really, I think this is more accurate in terms of relationships between parents and children. You have to let your kids go. They gotta go experience the world and live their own lives, but that doesn't mean that they love you any less or you have to love them any less. Your love just changes and adapts to you. Okay, next I watched the short film Night and Day. This one was quirky. I hadn't seen it before and I really enjoyed it. There are two characters, Night and Day, very fitting, and they're sketched cartoons. They're kind of simplistic in the original Disney style. However, they're filled with a world. Night embodies nighttime, so they have all sorts of sheep grazing in meadows and setting moons and the bright lights of Las Vegas, whereas day is made up of daytime scenes. So you have people at the pool, you have sunrise, all that jazz. Personification is a really big element of short films, whether that be Disney or Pixar. Bao, it's the dumpling, Night and Day, it's actual times of day. Lava, we're getting to that next. It's volcanoes that fall in love. I mean, personification is a big part of short films because it gets across a really simplistic, universal message that really applies to most people, but puts it in a context that it's not really designed to be in, and that makes it all the more touching and universal. At the end of the day, Night and Day focuses on the idea that friendship is really complementing another person. You don't have to be exactly the same. You don't have to be completely different. You can be, though, because friendship is really about being there for a person's highs and lows, filling in when they're weaker and allowing them to fill in for you and be the stronger one. Sometimes friendship is a balance. It also discusses the idea that the grass is always greener on the other side, and it's kind of a lifelong journey to accept who you are and the wonderful things you have inside of you. All right, I promised it. Here it is. Lava. This is about a little volcano man. The animation in this, again, incredible. But this volcano guy really wants to have like a life partner, you know, because the birds have each other, the dolphins are like doing flips and acrobatics in the air, the turtles are happy. Like, this guy's like, yay, I'm so happy for all of you. I wish I could have that too. And so he sings a song every day, wishing and dreaming that the love of his life will come along.
I have a dream I hope will come true. You're here with me, and I'm here with you. I wish that the earth, sea, the sky up above will send me someone to love.
Well, deep under the sea, there is another volcano, and her lava grows and grows, and then eventually they end up together, and their lava is, Oh, it's so cute. I think this was before Moana. I think I saw this before Moana. And I'm not gonna lie, I liked Lava more than Moana. Like, 10 times more than Moana. No shade to Moana, but like, not my fave. Lava was able to portray a full story arc with a combination of things. It really relied on the passage of time, facial expressions, and music. Music was used to tell a story in this case, and that's the one type of voiceover that I actually tend to really enjoy.
Oh, they were so happy to finally meet above the sea. All together now, their lava grew and grew.
Jerry's game takes place in a park. We're gonna say Central Park because it sounds nice. In the fall, there are red leaves, there are yellow leaves, there are orange leaves, there are brown leaves galore. And there is a little old guy named Jerry who sets up his chessboard on a table in Central Park. Now, the way this is animated is really unique and cool to me. It kind of looks like claymation. It might be claymation. I don't think it's claymation, but it does have that sort of aesthetic And I find that to be really nostalgic and sweet and just a really interesting way of telling a story. So Jerry sets up his chessboard, right? But there's no one to play with him, so he plays by himself. He will not be stopped by having no companion. And he creates kind of two characters for himself that both desperately want to win this chess game. And throughout, you're thinking, like, why? Like, yeah, it's nice to win. I like winning, too. It feels good. It's validating. But why is it so important? Well, you find out. It's because they're playing chess, obviously, and the winner gets to have the dentures for the day. And so Jerry number one, because they're, you know, Jerry number one wins, and he gets the dentures, and it just makes this whole day. And it's a really sweet animation. It's really a cute look at old age. It's kind of nostalgic because of the fall, but it also deals with topics such as loneliness, which is a huge epidemic, especially right now, but just in general, particularly among the elderly. Very anti-social media here. That's me. Hello. Delete Instagram and I will, like, you can have bragging rights. I'll give you a hug digitally. I know it's ironic. I'm on YouTube. I'll make a video on that someday. I feel like YouTube's a little different. We'll talk about that another time. But yeah, I hate social media, except when it comes to the elderly. I think the elderly are the people who should be using social media the most because they're clearly the loneliest. And it's really important to connect. And when you're physically unable to connect in person, I think the media would be a stellar way to do that. Unfortunately, older people are the demographic that are probably using social media the least. So, teenagers, get your grandma on Instagram and then delete your own. It's just a really adorable short. It has a message, it has a purpose, but it'll also leave you smiling. This one is for sure on YouTube, so I definitely recommend you check it out. Thank you so much for watching today, everyone. Feel free to subscribe, comment, let me know what your favorite short is. If it's one that wasn't on this list, please tell me because I want to watch as many as humanly possible. And yeah, I hope you're well. I will see you on Tuesday.
A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply.